Up to this point, we have finished the introduction of the Bellman optimality equation, which provides a powerful tool to analyze the optimal policy and the optimal state value. Now let's apply this tool to analyze optimal policies and their interesting properties. First, we need to answer an important question. What factors determine the optimal policy? If we don't understand the Bellman optimality equation, it is difficult to answer this question. However, with the Bellman optimality equation, it is easy to answer this question. This is the Bellman optimality equation. We need to solve these unknown quantities, which are in black, corresponding to the optimal policy and optimal state value. Known quantities are in red. They include the probability that represents the system model, reward R, and the discount rate gamma. Solving the Bellman optimality equation means determining the unknown quantities, which are in black, based on these known values, which are in red. Clearly, the optimal policy and optimal state value are determined by these known quantities, which include the reward design, the choice of discount rate gamma, and the system model. Suppose that the model is fixed. Now let's explore how changes in the reward or gamma affect the optimal policy. In a grid world example with a target area, the rewards are designed as follows. Exiting the boundary or entering a forbidden area incurs a -1 penalty. Reaching the target grants +1, and the discount rate gamma is 0.9. By solving the Bellman optimality equation using the algorithm introduced earlier, we can solve and plot the optimal policy and its corresponding state values. Observing the optimal policy reveals an interesting phenomenon. Contrary to the expectation to avoid forbidden areas, the optimal policy may choose to pass through them to reach the target area. For example, starting from here and moving right, the agent enters the forbidden area and goes through it to reach the target area. This is because, despite a temporary penalty, the long-term return of crossing directly is greater than taking a longer detour around the forbidden area. By changing parameters such as rewards or the discount rate, we can observe how the optimal policy evolves. In this example, all parameters remain the same as before, except for the discount rate gamma, which changes from 0.9 to 0.5. This is the optimal policy, and this is the optimal state value. The optimal policy has already been changed. Previously, the policy moves right through the forbidden area, but now it changes to moving left, taking a larger detour around the forbidden area. This change is because the agent assesses that the return from taking a larger detour is greater than the return from crossing directly. It is due to the change of gamma. As mentioned before, a higher value of gamma suggests a more far-sighted agent that values future rewards significantly. Conversely, a smaller gamma results in a short-sighted agent whose return is primarily determined by immediate rewards. With a small gamma, future rewards are heavily discounted, lowering their impact on the agent's present decisions. Reducing gamma further to zero demonstrates another change in the optimal policy. In this case, the policy is extremely short-sighted. The agent focuses solely on the immediate reward. Why? If GT is the return, it is calculated as RT plus 1 plus gamma times RT plus 2 and so on. If gamma equals zero, it implies that all subsequent values are zero. This means that no matter what return I can receive in the future, once it is discounted, everything becomes zero. Thus, the return is exactly the immediate reward. As a result, the optimal policy would simply choose the action that maximizes the immediate reward. For example, starting from here, when the agent moves upwards, it will hit a wall or enter a forbidden area, resulting in a negative reward. Moving to the right or down also yields a negative reward. Staying still or moving to the left results in a reward of zero. Therefore, it will either stay still or move to the left. In our program, we randomly choose one of them, and in this case, the agent chooses to stay still. Let's have a look at another case, starting from here. Because the state is adjacent to the target area, it will enter it. Why? Moving upwards yields zero, moving to the right yields zero, and moving downwards yields zero, while staying still incurs a penalty of -1. Therefore, it will move to the left to receive a positive reward. As a result, it naturally chooses this action. In summary, when gamma equals zero, the optimal policy becomes extremely short-sighted. Starting from many states, it simply cannot reach the target area by the optimal policy. Let's examine another scenario where all parameters are the same as scenario A, except for one difference. The penalty for entering forbidden areas increases from -1 to -10. indicating a more severe punishment for entering forbidden areas. Consequently, the policy naturally changes to avoid the forbidden area by moving around it. Here, gamma is set to 0.9. When reducing gamma to 0.5, the policy still avoids forbidden areas. However, by significantly increasing the penalty for forbidden areas while maintaining gamma at 0.9, the policy adapts to avoid forbidden areas. This example illustrates how changing rewards R or the discount factor gamma can influence the optimal policy. Next, we consider another crucial situation. What happens when every reward R is multiplied by a factor A and then added to a bias B, resulting in AR plus B? Will the optimal policy change? Let's consider a specific example, which is frequently used. Boundary and forbidden areas have a reward R of negative 1, and the target area has a reward of positive 1. Now we add 1 to all rewards. As a result, the rewards for boundary and forbidden areas become 0, and the reward for the target area becomes 2. Additionally, the reward for any other step becomes 1. Why is there an other step? That is, the reward for moving from one white cell to another is 0, indicating no reward or punishment. However, when adding a bias of 1, these 0 rewards become positive 1. After making such changes, the ultimate optimal policy does not change. Why is that? Because what matters is not the absolute value of the rewards, but their relative values. Such a property can be more rigorously stated in a theorem. Understanding this will lead to a deeper comprehension of the topic. First, let's examine this Bellman optimality equation, whose optimal solution is V star. I have now changed every R to AR plus B. Then, the corresponding Bellman optimality equation becomes V prime equals max pi, R pi prime plus gamma P pi V prime. Also, R pi prime is different from the previous R pi. It is then observed that V prime, the solution to this Bellman optimality equation, relates to V star in such a manner that it is multiplied by an additional A, and then plus this term. When calculating the optimal policy, we need to consider the action value. According to V star, we can determine the action value for each state. Similarly, knowing V prime allows for the calculation of each action value. We will find that this action value has a relationship with the previous action value, being multiplied by an additional A and then adding a bias. When calculating the optimal policy, I do not consider the absolute action values, but rather their relative values. For example, if the original action values were 1, 2, 1, 1, 1 for the 5 actions, I would choose the second action. However, if they become 100, 200s, 100, etc., I would go for 200s, as I always choose the largest one, regardless of their absolute values. Detailed proof of this theorem can be found in my book. Next, let's look at another example, which may be tricky to understand. Initially, on the left is a very simple grid world with 4 grids. By solving the Bellman optimality equation, we can obtain such an optimal policy and the optimal state value. On the right, the difference lies in the movement being left instead of down in this state, which clearly is not an optimal policy. This is its corresponding state value. It is apparent that its state value is smaller than that of the optimal policy. Thus, it is not an optimal policy. But why isn't this considered an optimal policy? Why taking such a detour would make it non-optimal? When we design R, moving from one white area to another white area results in R being 0. It seems that with no penalty, we can move from here to there, and even return and circulate as desired. So, why isn't this optimal? The answer is quite simple. It is due to the discount rate. In particular, if you directly jump here, you would receive a positive 1, and then continuing yields a constant positive 1, thus gamma 1, gamma squared 1, and so forth, resulting in such a value. If it were the latter case, the first reward is 0, followed by another 0, then 1, thus 0, 0, 1. Compared to the former scenario, this introduces an additional gamma square term, thereby reducing the state value. What am I trying to say through this example? When designing rewards, many people might think there should be a penalty for each step taken, such as setting R equals negative 1. This can represent a consumption of energy. With such a setting, the agent would not take detours and would seek the shortest path to the target area. Otherwise, if R equals 0, without the penalty of R equals negative 1, we may think that it may result in a longer path. But is this really the case? Through our discussion, we know that it is not so. Apart from using R to discourage taking longer paths, we also have the discount rate gamma. Taking a longer path means the reward for reaching the goal is delayed, and the later it is, the smaller the power of gamma becomes, significantly reducing the reward. Therefore, it naturally seeks the shortest path to proceed. This concludes all the content for this lecture. Let's briefly summarize. First, we discussed the Bellman optimality equation, which has two expressions, one in element-wise form and the other in matrix vector form. Does the Bellman optimality equation have solutions? We know for sure that a solution exists. Is this solution unique? We know that the solution is indeed unique, according to the contraction mapping theorem. It is important to note that the solution for the optimal state value is unique. However, the optimal policy that corresponds to this optimal state value may not be unique. How to solve this equation? We have presented an iterative algorithm suggested by the contraction mapping theorem. Additionally, regarding optimality, we know that the solution to the Bellman optimality equation, including the state value and the policy, is optimal. This is why we study the Bellman optimality equation. That is all for this lecture.